Okay, so we started out when we first came in the room talking about how exhausted you must be. This has been such a whirlwind.
It has been a whirlwind. You know, first of all, the basketball season went a week longer than it ever has. And of course, we played to the last day you could possibly play on, thankfully. But then after that, it was going to Caitlin's Wooden Award in LA, New York for the draft, recruiting at our campus, team banquets. And so it's been a whirlwind, but it's been a good one.
Yeah. The intensity of the past two seasons has to be unparalleled for anything else you've experienced as a head coach. How are you going to cope with all of this kind of plateauing?
Yeah, we're waiting for the crash, right? When all this calms down. You know, in our sport, though, it doesn't calm down a lot. I mean, we go right into recruiting and camps and golf tournaments and all this sort of stuff that we are, you know, really working on year round. But the intensity of the season is certainly at a whole different level. And our season was even longer last year because we had our foreign tour. Yep. We had our crossover in Kinnick with 56,000 people come out for our exhibition game. So that even extended it longer.
Right. What kind of goals do you have now, looking beyond sort of the Caitlin vortex that we've all been living in? What's next?
Yeah, what's next is, you know, being able to bring in another group of really high quality individuals and blend them together to be the best that we can be. You know, I'm always a John Wooden fan, and it was always, you know, everybody judges you on wins and losses, but really, were you the best you could be that year with that particular group? And to me, that's the most important thing.
To that end, I've heard you talk a number of times about the transfer portal and the challenges that presents, but also that you've had the opportunity to get players that may be really good players, but they don't fit the culture. Talk about the culture that you've built.
Yeah, I think the culture of our program is what makes it special, and I think that we have beaten teams that have more physical talent than we have. But we have the better culture. We have a team that believes in each other and works together and stays positive. So the culture in our program is something, it's not a seminar that you do in a weekend. It's something we work on daily. It's not just words we slap up on a wall. It's something that, it's how we live each and every day and trying to have our student athletes understand that and value it.
Part of what I want to do with this interview with you, if you're game for it, is eventually put together a longer form story about you and what makes you you and the coach that you are and the way you inspire people. So I'm curious about you as a kid, you know? I mean, how would you describe yourself and what are sort of like the pillars, if you will, since we're here for this pillar award, of your personality and the essence of you?
You know, I was a kid that always had tons of energy. Like, I would just go and go and go and go. I was the middle of five kids, and my dad put up a basketball hoop for my two older brothers, and they could care less about it, and I was the one that wore it out. So I guess I've just always really been interested in athletics. It was an outlet for me. It was a way for me to expend that energy and give me a team. I didn't have an older sister. I always wanted to have an older sister. And, you know, a team gave me that kind of a general feeling.
Yeah. Did you ever dream as a little girl, as a young woman playing basketball, that this is where you would be 40, 50 years later?
Never. I mean, I never, ever had those dreams. I mean, and I think it's really important to have goals and to have visions. And that's kind of like, I didn't have that a whole lot. I mean, the first Olympic basketball team was in 1976. And I can remember vividly sitting there and watching that and saying, I want to do that. So we have to have role models. We have to have that vision in order to accomplish something. And I think our team provided that for a lot of young boys and girls this year.
Yeah, it's been transformative. How do you feel about bringing so many new eyeballs to the game of women's basketball?
You know, when you're in the moment, you have no idea, right? Like, you're just in this bubble and you don't have any idea what's going on around you. And then you kind of hear, you know, some of these numbers and it's overwhelming a little bit. Like, really, that many people care about our game now. It's so special. And we just have to keep building this momentum.
You have been a transformative coach at all of the programs you've coached at, St. Ambrose, Drake, Iowa. What do you attribute that to?
Well, I've been at three great places. I mean, I'm proud that they've all been in Iowa. I'm an Iowa girl. So to me, you know, spending my entire coaching career in this state has been really special. And I think each one of those places is just magnificent. I really do. They're special in their own way. And so I think I've been surrounded with great staff. I've been able to recruit wonderful players, but I've also had really good leadership at each of those places.
Mm-hmm. Talking about Caitlin as a player, and even some of the other, you know, high-level players that you've mm-hmm. had on your team at Iowa, how do you manage that in a locker room? I mean, there's team, but everybody also comes to the table with an ego.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, that can be a really difficult part of putting together a team, is how do you manage all the egos? Because every one of them was all state when they come in here. When you have a star like Caitlin, I think the best thing is to do is to talk about it, to let everybody know this person is special. Their star shines really bright, but when it shines bright, it shines on all of us. And so we're all reaping the benefits. And our team really bought into that and believed it. But also, I think it's how you manage that star. You know, are they humble? Do they credit their teammates? Are they the hardest worker, on the court? That, if they do those things, it really does help.
Everybody keeps talking about her as a generational talent. I mean, many of us view you as a generational women's basketball mm-hmm. coach.
Well, that means a lot. It really does, because, I mean, I had, you know, role models when I was starting out in this, like Vivian Stringer and Pat Summitt and Tara Vanderveer. And so, you know, if I can do that for somebody else, that would be a real honor.
I get asked a lot, and I feel like this is a sexist question, so I sort of hate posing it to you, but the whole idea of work-life balance, mm-hmm. I mean, this is a grueling, grueling job and mm-hmm. schedule that you keep, not just during the season, but year-round. I saw your mom in an interview a number of years ago say, well, she's proof that you can have it all. Do you feel that way?
I think you can have it all, but I don't think you can do it without a strong partner. Mm-hmm. And Dave, and you know, we've been married a long time, and he has been so supportive. And without him, I could not do what I have done. We couldn't have had the family that we have. And so I just think that if you're going to have a job like this that requires a lot, you have to have the strongest partner.
Yeah. I had forgotten about this until I was Googling that he was critically mm-hmm. injured, hit by a car, mm-hmm. and in a coma for a number of days.
Yep.
How did you get through that?
Well, when that accident happened, I was actually at a Final Four, and a friend of mine called and said, you need to get home quickly. And I got home, and I was actually pregnant with our oldest daughter at the time. And it's shocking, because when you see somebody that you love like that, you just think, well, there's the end of life as I know it. And luckily, we've had so much great support, and the medical team here was so great in Des Moines, and all of our friends, and Dave has recovered. And so it's a shock, but you know, also it does kind of make you stop and pause and think of what's really important and what you value in life. I think a lot of people could use that example, you know, that lesson earlier in their life than at the end. A lot of times people think about it then.
Last question, because I know we're on a time crunch. There's been a lot of buzz this week about the pay disparity between Caitlin and her male counterpart, mm-hmm. WNBA versus NBA. Mm-hmm. There's also pay disparity between you and your male counterpart at the university. What do you think needs to change?
You know, I haven't given a whole lot of thought to that yet. It's something that, you know, certainly needs to be addressed. But people, you know, need to talk about it above me. They, you know, I'm not going to be this crusader that goes out there and tries to demand that. I've tried to show up for work and do the best that I can every single day, and hopefully be rewarded for that. And I have been generously rewarded for that. But do I believe in equality? 100%.
So let's get into that a little mm-hmm. bit more. I mean, life changes a lot when a baby comes along.
Mm-hmm. It does. And we did have a nanny for the first year that Hannah was around, Drake here in Des Moines. But David was a vice president of the West Branch Bank. And really we kind of looked at each other and said, you know, do we really want to have somebody else bringing up our children? And we had this deep discussion, and it was him that said, I think I can probably get back into my career a little bit easier than you could yours. So it was his idea to actually step away and raise our children. One turned into three, and he never went back. But he has written a book, The Great Gamble, so he's doing other things that are very meaningful.
Yeah, I actually read about his book. Okay. I think it's so interesting, in the midst of this rise of sports betting and gambling in our state.
Well, he wrote this book. He started about 10 years ago, or maybe even longer, before it was even really talked about in our state. And so this really came out during COVID, and then all of this, you know, the sports gambling and things have really exploded since that time. So what was an extremely fictitious book has turned into a little bit more reality.
Yeah. How would you describe him as a dad?
Oh, Dave is the best dad. Dave is the dad that would be able to and feel very comfortable taking his son to football practice or his daughter to dance lesson and shopping for prom dresses and going to all their appointments. He has been totally vested in their lives. And I think it's such a great example for women to see that a dad, a man, can do this, can, you know, really take care of their children and bring them up with great morals and values. But also I think it's good for our son to see that this is the type of young man that you're going to be and how you're going to treat women and how much respect you're going to have for your family.
Well, and I think there's a lot to be said, too, about seeing their mom in the sort of role that you are in.
I think there is, you know, something to that. My daughters, I believe, that, you know, they dream big. I hope my son dreams big, too. But they have seen their mom in a different role, a leadership role. They've seen me at my high and low points, for sure. But, you know, I just want to be the best mom I can be at the end of the day.
Yeah. A lot of people would argue that you, meaning all of us, learn more from losing than from winning. Do you think that's true?
You know, I do think there's a lot of reality to that. I think when you win, you just think everything's going right and you cruise along with that. But when you lose, you really step back and say, why did that happen? And as long as you do that, as long as you really process that loss, it can be so beneficial because now you can change course, right? You can fix things that maybe were being ignored before. And so I think losing, athletics teaches you how to bounce back from failure, but it also teaches you how to learn from that. And I think that's instrumental.
What would you list as the most challenging thing in your life that you faced?
Time management, most likely. I mean, for me, you know, recruiting and going on the road is hard because you're missing a lot of your kids' activities, and I have missed a lot of my own children's activities because I've been out watching other children. And to me, that's kind of the sad part, the part that's hard. And I always apologize to my kids when they're, I was like, Mom, no, we get to do all these great things because of your job, whether it's being in this arena or going on this foreign tour. So they have had a lot of great experiences that other people haven't gotten, but certainly I have missed out on some of theirs.
Yeah, you still have a big job to do. Are you going to be going to Fever basketball games?
I don't know how many Fever games I'm going to get to, and I have two players on the Las Vegas Aces team now, mm-hmm. with Kate Martin also being drafted and Megan Gustafson on that team. So maybe when they meet, I'll be able to get to that game.
That would be a moment.
That would be fun.
Okay.